All right, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. The Department of Health Nassau Baptist Health welcome you tonight to our ongoing series on health equity during Minority Health Month. Together, we want to ask the right questions, have meaningful conversations, and better understand and address these issues that impact our community. We must also mobilize to address it. Health equity must become part of the practice, process, action, innovation, performance, and ultimately the outcomes that show reduction in gaps that are unjust, avoidable, unnecessary, and unfair. We have the opportunity and obligation to not only turn the page, but to do better and achieve more equitable health outcomes. We have a special presentation tonight on the importance of early detection and screenings, and I'll turn it over to Lynn here shortly to make that introduction. But first and foremost, we want to go over some housekeeping. If we can go to the next slide. This session is being recorded. For your viewing preferences, we recommend using SpeakerView. And throughout the session, please feel free to use the chat feature with any questions or comments that you might have. So with that said, I will turn it over to Lynn to make our introductions.
Good evening, everyone. I am Lynn Sherman, and I have the pleasure of introducing you to a person who is going to share some very important information with us this evening concerning cancer screenings. Her name is Carolyn Austin. Carolyn is a registered nurse with her master's in science of nursing and oncology nursing certification. She is the lung cancer screening program coordinator at Baptist MD Anderson Cancer Center. She developed the lung cancer screening program and is very, very passionate about cancer screenings overall. And so she has some information that we all need to have. And we look forward to Carolyn sharing this information with you all this evening. Carolyn?
Hi there. Good evening. Nice to present to you all. So I started in lung cancer screening and have just seen some amazing progress with it in finding cancer early when it is curable. And I'll go through some more of that later. So this particular presentation is talking about several different screenings to help educate and promote people to be health advocates and find cancer early. God forbid they ever have it. Next slide. So we have been talking a lot in the lung cancer community about disparities, and the African-American disparities are quite disturbing. There's going to be 224,000 new cancer cases, and over 73,000 cancer deaths are expected to be among Black people in 2022. And unfortunately, Black people have the highest death rate and lowest survival of any racial ethnic group in the United States for most cancers. Next slide. So for lung cancer is the leading death for Black men, also for white men. But during the recent five-year period, Black men had a 6% higher incidence and a 19% higher mortality than white men overall. So we are definitely seeing a gap here that we need to work on. Breast cancer is the leading cancer death among Black women. And Black women are 41% more likely to die from breast cancer than white women, despite having a lower incidence of disease. So we feel education and helping people be their best advocate is the way to go here. Next slide. So on the left is African-American male mortality rates. And as you can see, lung is very high. And then next is prostate and then colorectum. For females, it used to be lung. And in 2019, breast cancer surpassed that. So encouraging breast cancer screening among African-American females is very important. And their third highest is colorectal cancer as well. And these top cancers have screenings that if we just educate individuals about screenings, we can certainly help these numbers. Next slide. So these are the disparities between Black and white individuals. The red line is the Black death rate, and the blue line is the white death rate. So for males, the Black death rate's much higher. For colorectal, It's much higher than for white males. For breasts, the Black death rate is much higher than for white females. And for lung females, it's actually white individuals have a higher mortality rate in females than Black. But for colorectal in females, the Black death rate is much higher than white. Next slide. So now let's go into what screenings do we need and when do we need them? So breast cancer screening has been around for a long time. And it's encouraged for age 40 plus every year. You get it every year. There's no order needed. To have it done at any Baptist facility, you can call the main central scheduling number, which is 202-2222. And you do need a primary care doctor because they do need to send the report to someone. And so if you need a primary care doctor, 202 for you can certainly help you find one near you, which is most convenient for you. And the insurance covers mammograms at 100%. And so if there are some individuals who do not have insurance, and we'll discuss that later, how we can help them. Next slide. Colon cancer is found, if it's found at early stage before it's spread, the survival rate is very high. It's 90%. But only 40% of colorectal cancers are actually found at this early stage. And we do have some new options. We do have one new option, which might be beneficial for individuals who do not like colonoscopies. Next slide. So colon cancer screening, everybody should be screened at age 45 plus. They recently reduced this age because some younger individuals were getting colon cancer, and because they weren't of the age to screen, they unfortunately are found at later stages. If you have a personal family history of colorectal cancer or polyps, then you may be encouraged to get it earlier. And it's every 5 to 10 years, depending on your risk, and the primary care doctor can order it. Next slide. So the options are colonoscopy, which there's at-home prep, followed by a 30-minute procedure, and you're sleeping during the procedure. And the PrEP, they have other options now for PrEP rather than the ginormous amounts of Go Lightly that you have to drink. They have Sure PrEP, which is much less to drink, which I did recently, and it really wasn't that bad. And the procedure, I mean, you come in, you basically go to sleep, you wake up, and it's done. It's very simple. The Cologuard is an option if someone does not want a colonoscopy. It's an at-home test that detects altered DNA or blood in the stool, and it's 90% effective. So this is super easy for them, for individuals to send in a stool sample to look for any altered DNA or blood in the stool. It's great, and insurance covers it, which is very exciting. Next slide. So Cologuard is fine for average risk individuals. If you have colorectal cancer in your family, especially a direct relative like your parents, it's not recommended. They recommend an actual colonoscopy because your risk is much higher. But it detects the DNA in blood and stool. Primary care doctor can order it, so you don't need to go to a special doctor. And like I said, insurance covers it. Next slide. So for the colonoscopy, the insurance covers it at 100% for screening. If they happen to find anything, they remove it, such as polyps or anything that looks abnormal. And that a coinsurance may apply at that case. The Cologuard covered at 100%. Now, if you do have a positive test with Cologuard, they do recommend a colonoscopy, which could also cost an out-of-pocket additional cost. Next slide. So lung cancer screening, this is my wheelhouse. I developed the program back in 2015 for Baptist MD Anderson. The qualifications have recently changed. And the age has reduced from 55 to 50. So it's age 50 to 77. You should be asymptomatic, meaning if you have any kind of lung cancer symptoms, you should go for a diagnostic CT chest. So a lot of smokers or current smokers do tend to have a little bit of a cough or raspy voice. That's not lung cancer symptom. You're looking for something that's new and has been around for the past month that won't go away. such as a cough that all of a sudden started a month ago and won't go away, or throat soreness that started a month ago and won't go away, or any kind of chest pain. Those are things we need to look into and see what's going on. You have to be a current cigarette smoker or quit in the last 15 years. 20-pack year history. So what a 20-pack year history is, the pack year is calculated by calculating the number of years you have smoked by the number of packs per day. So if you smoked one pack per day for 20 years, that's a 20-pack year history. And the insurance covers it at 100%. If you are not within this criteria, there's a self-pay rate, which is $115. That is for the CT scan and for the radiologist to read it. So you can still get it done. My mom had a lot of secondhand smoke, and so she was really concerned about it. So she gets her lung cancer screening every year. We don't have enough research about secondhand smoke. So she just does it just to cover all her bases. Next slide. So this is the old way of screening for lung cancer for a chest x-ray, which is very difficult because you have ribs in the way. It's very hard to see. It's very hazy. So this was not ideal. And that's why they started doing some research to see if a low dose CT scan would be beneficial. Next slide. And this is what a CT scan shows. I mean, we can find nodules that are as tiny as 2 millimeters. And we can watch them to see if they're growing. You get a lung cancer screening every year. So sometimes nodules pop up and sometimes they just disappear. But the CT scan is best to watch it and make sure nothing's happening. Next slide. So these are our program results. If you look at the blue, that was before lung cancer screening in Florida. Most of the lung cancers were found in distant stage, which has a very poor survival rate. I mean, 5-6% survival rate. It's very sad. But since our program has started, that's in the red. And you see almost 70% of our patients are found in localized stage, which has a very high survival rate. So for me, it was very exciting because when I was the lung cancer nurse navigator, most of my patients were stage 4. And unfortunately, I lost most of them. There are new treatments in lung cancer, but which are helping our stage 4 patients, but we still have a long way to go in that respect. So the best way to find it early is lung cancer screening. Next slide. So this is the survival rate for lung cancer. So if you look at the bottom stage 4, it's very low. And this is after 5 years of battling the disease. But if you find it in stage 1A1, it's 92% survival rate, which is very exciting. So I love it when I find my early stage lung cancer. So I do a little celebration. So I really think lung cancer screening is going to change the world of lung cancer, and we will have many more lung cancer survivors. Next slide. So there's a lot of misconceptions about lung cancer. If a person hasn't smoked in several years, we have individuals who think, I quit, I'm not at risk anymore. We watch you for 15 years. And I'll tell you, the majority of my patients, we find lung cancer after their fourth or fifth scan. So we watch you for a long time after you quit. And lung cancer is not hereditary. So I've had patients tell me that I don't have a family history of lung cancer. It's not hereditary. And I don't have any symptoms. Unfortunately, once you have symptoms, it's typically stage 3 to 4. And so we try to find it before you have any symptoms at all. Next slide. Next slide, please. So cancer prevention. There are several ways to help prevent cancer. So avoiding tobacco products is very important. It causes more cancer than just lung cancer, which I'll go over next. Low alcohol consumption, healthy weight, staying active throughout your life, and eating a healthy range diet. Next slide. So these are the other cancers that tobacco causes. We see a lot of urinary cancers and uterine cancers from smoking. So that's kind of a misconception that people think that smoking only causes lung cancer. And so we are trying to educate individuals that it can also cause head and neck cancer. It can cause leukemia. It can cause kidney and renal cancer. So it's really important to get your screenings and be your best health advocate. Next slide. So if you do know someone who's smoking, there are many options, and this really improves their quit rate. Tobacco Free Florida is helps via phone and text, and they give you 2 weeks free of nicotine replacement therapy. And all of this is free. And AHEC has local smoking cessation classes. You can do virtual or in-person. And if you finish a six-week class, you get more nicotine replacement therapy for free. So these are great options for people. And unfortunately, smoking is as addictive as heroin. So it takes a bit for individuals to quit. So they need all the support that they can get. So it's really beneficial to reach out to these organizations. Next slide. So speaking of being your own advocate, Natalie Brown suffered from a light cough and unusual fatigue. And she kept going back to her doctors, and but they said, "You're too young. You don't smoke. You can't have lung cancer." Well, it took months to finally receive an answer, and she was diagnosed at stage 4 adenocarcinoma at just 33 years old. So 15% of lung cancers are caused by smoking. So it's really important to be your own advocate and continue to ask questions and request for tests. Next slide. It's also important to advocate for someone in your sphere of influence. If you have a friend or a family member who is due to get their cancer screening, encourage them, go with them. If they have trouble communicating with their doctor, go with them to their doctor visit and help them. It's important for them to get regular checkups and talk openly with their doctor. Again, 15% of lung cancer is not caused by smoking. And so if you have any kind of lung issues, an unexplained cough or any kind of pain or exhaustion, when you just don't understand what's going on, investigate and help your doctor investigate and push them to investigate it. So you can request a CT scan. You can request a colonoscopy if you have GI issues. There are a lot of GI cancers that are in younger individuals in 30s and early 40s. So if you have something that's just not right, have a colonoscopy and check it out and make sure everything's okay. Next slide. So the Lung Research Foundation is actually promoting this to help you be your own advocate to detect early stage lung cancer. So it's called BREATHE, the acronym is BREATHE. And so if you have any kind of blood when you cough or spit, that could be indicative of lung cancer. Recurring respiratory infections, and during a cough that's new or different and is going on for a long time, ache or pain in your shoulder, back, or chest. Typically, the pain will radiate from the lung to other areas. Any trouble breathing, hoarseness, or wheezing, and exhaustion, or weakness, or lack of appetite. Cancer cells tend to drain your energy. So if that's new, then that's something that you need to encourage, talk to your doctor about, see what kind of tests you can do to find out about it. Next slide. So here are some resources for those individuals who do not have insurance. JAS Care Connect is for Duval County residents and provides access to healthcare. It's for individuals who are 250% below poverty. So they make about $32,000 a year or less, and they're uninsured. And they can help be your primary care doctor and order screenings for you. Next slide. The Pink Ribbon screening is in the greater Jacksonville area, and it's providing access to free mammograms for uninsured. They must have a primary care doctor. But if you're interested in, or you have a friend who needs this, you can contact Jack's Care Connect or clinics for a referral for the referral to the Pink Ribbon screening. Next slide. In Nassau County, we have Barnabas Clinic, and that's free primary care services and financial assistance. And they refer patients to us for lung screenings. We have a certain amount that we of screenings that we provide for free. And then in Clay County, we have the Department of Health, and we have Azza Health, which offers financial assistance. Next slide. So this is my phone number and my email address. You're welcome to reach out to me anytime if you have any questions, or if your doctor has questions, they can call me anytime. I'm always happy to help. We have any questions? Let's
see. Hi, Carolyn. Yes, we do have some questions. We have some questions that were sent in prior to the webinar or the recording, and we want to make sure that we answer those questions. And we also have a question from our audience. And while we do the question and answer session, if we could just stop share the slide presentation, and then we'll be able to ask the questions, and people can see your lovely face as we do this. So one question that we have is, how can I help my doctor investigate my symptoms? What can a person say to their doctor that will really encourage them to move further in trying to diagnose what's going on with them?
I think it's important to ask for tests. Let's say you have something going on in your chest, your lungs, your breathing's problem. It's important to ask. So I want a CT chest. I want to find out if there's anything else going on. If you have any kind of like abdominal pain or issues, like my husband recently had some pain and it was diverticulitis. Well, if he has diverticulitis, he has higher risk for colon cancer. So he needs to go get his colonoscopy. So it's just asking for it. I think that's what is important. I think doctors sometimes are hesitant to put individuals through so many tests, but it's better than not knowing and dealing with these issues on your own. So I am very big on my own health, and I ask for things. I inquire because I want to know what's going on. And I'm so big on cancer screening, so I make sure if there's something going on, I want to find it early.
That is a very good point. Just ask for what you think you need. And I know that many people feel like the doctor is so important that they can't ask them, and they feel like the doctor is the expert, and if he doesn't bring it up, then it must not be important. So I think it's really important for us to give them this message that it's so important that they ask the question. So I have another question here for you. Is there ever a reason when a person should begin or have a colonoscopy sooner than 40 or at age 40?
Yes, they should get it earlier if they have any kind of family history. If they have a history of polyps or even diverticuli, or if they have any issues. If they're having any issues such as recurrent colon problems, like diarrhea issues or any kind of abdominal pain that you're like, it's just not getting better. It's not a one-time thing. You're suffering for months or that requires some more investigation. So you can ask your doctor to order the colonoscopy due to symptoms.
Thank you, Carolyn. So some people really do have a fear of colonoscopies. I find it a little difficult to understand, but some people really do. Would a suggestion to try the Cologuard be better than no screening at all, despite the Cologuard having lower sensitivity? Should they do something rather than nothing?
Absolutely. That's why I'm really excited we have Cologuard now, and I don't think a lot of people know about it. But yes, if you're going to do nothing, do the Cologuard. It's super easy. It's not not invasive, and you don't have to prep, and do that. It's 90% effective. So that's great.
So interesting. So has overall in screenings, has COVID-19 impacted the rate of cancer screening? And if so, what are the upcoming projections for the stages once detected?
Yeah, so during the pandemic, cancer screenings went way down, and which is not good because the cancer numbers aren't going down. finding it early is going down. So unfortunately, they're anticipating by 2030, we're going to have a higher cancer death rate for that. So we are really clean at Baptist Health and make sure to clean machines in between each patient, make sure to wear masks. They're very big on getting people back in to get their cancer screening so we can find that cancer early.
That's going to be really important that we encourage, and we serve as advocates, and we encourage other people to serve as advocates to get screened. So this question is about breast cancer. If a woman has been told that she has dense breast, should she have what is called a fast MRI or an MRI instead of a mammogram or in addition to a mammogram? What do you know about having the fast MRI?
So we have a new, we have new mammogram machines at Baptist that are better for dense breasts because I have dense breasts. So they're better. They can tell more. It's not 100%, but you can speak to your primary care doctor. And if you want an MRI, if you're more concerned, or if there's some other symptom that you're concerned about, definitely request it from the primary care doctor, from your primary care doctor, because they can order that. But the new FOMO machines are much better for the radiologist to actually spot anything suspicious.
So is it covered by insurance, do you know?
Yep.
If it's ordered by 100%. Physician? Okay, very good. Very good. So this next question says, I have a friend who had an annual mammogram without fail, but she found a lump in her breast that was not picked up on mammography. How could that happen? And what can women do to prevent that from occurring?
So this is why they still recommend self-breast exams every month, because some cancers are more aggressive, so they grow pretty fast. And so they recommend every month you do your self-breast exam so you can find if something's popping up in between your annual mammograms, then you can go to your doctor right away and it's time for another mammogram. And they might even go straight to diagnostic MRI.
Thanks for answering that. That's we get that question a lot, really. So I have a question about lung cancer. So why is it so that so many people in Northeast Florida over the past few years who have never smoked are being diagnosed with lung cancer?
So 15% of lung cancers are non-smokers, and I've taken care of a lot of young individuals who have stage 4 lung cancer. Because they're non-smokers, it's not on their radar. So they may have chest symptoms and not even think about it. So one risk is any kind of like asbestos exposure, other chemical exposure. If you work in a chemical plant, like a paper plant, another risk is radon. And you can go, if you search radon tests on Google, it's $15. They mail it to you. You put it in your house at the lowest level. And radon is a type of radiation that comes out of the ground. So then you send it in and they'll give you the test results. So I've done it in every house I live.
That's very interesting. I'll bet you many people don't even think about doing radon testing in their homes. It certainly reminds me that that's something I need to do in my own. So
up north, that causes that because they have basements. So in Florida, it's not so, we don't have a high radon level here, but up north, it's something that should definitely be on the radar.
I see, but it happens here in Northeast Florida. So I think we might need to investigate that or something else a little bit more frequently. So this question says that my aunt died of lung cancer about 10 years ago, but she never smoked. However, she lives with my uncle who smoked 2 packs a day every day. He just died of a heart attack 2 weeks ago. Could she have gotten lung cancer from just being around and living in the household with his cigarette smoking?
It's absolutely possible. The problem, we don't have a lot of evidence about secondhand smoke because it's very difficult to measure that. We can measure how much people smoke by packs per year, but with secondhand smoke, it depends on how much time did you spend with the person? How much are they smoking? Are they smoking inside or outside? So it's very difficult to measure that to see how much exposure can actually cause lung cancer. So if you have someone, a friend or a loved one who is getting exposed to secondhand smoke, I encourage them to do the self-pay route and get a lung cancer screening every year.
Okay, thank you for that. Thank you for that. I have another, just one more lung cancer question, screening question. What are the risks of side effects from the CT screening that a person would have? Should they be worried about too much radiation with getting a screening for lung cancer?
So for the lung cancer screening, it's actually a low dose CT. It's about a quarter of the amount of radiation compared to a regular CT chest. So the risk is extremely low. So the risk for them getting lung cancer is higher than any kind of risk that they have with the low dose radiation. So we still encourage them to get screened. We've had many studies around the world that have showed how beneficial lung cancer screening is. And they've been studying it now for the past 15 years. So the risk is definitely low.
Thank you for that. Do you have any recommendations, some easy to read, simple literature that can be passed on to friends and relatives so that they can understand the need for low dose lung cancer screening for smokers?
Yeah, I mean, I think the important thing is if you have someone who has a smoking history or who is a current smoker, encourage them to talk to their doctor to get their screening done. If they're 50 and up, then they are probably eligible if they have a history of smoking, because a 20-pack year history is pretty low. So I encourage them to talk to their doctor, but it's really important to find it before there are any symptoms. And that's what I don't think people understand. The nerve fibers in the lung, there aren't any nerves in the lung. It's when the lung cancer actually starts to progress outside of the lung that then you get symptoms. So it's really hard to know if there's a small nodule in there growing. And we find nodules 2 milliliters. And when they get to about 8, which is really tiny, that's when we start to worry about them. Mm. So waiting is not a good option, because by the time you have symptoms, then it's too late.
I'm so glad that you put emphasis on that, because sometimes people don't really understand that they don't have to have symptoms in order to be to have lung cancer. And so it's so important that if they meet the criteria, that they should get screening. So thanks again for sharing that. I'm going to go back a little bit to colorectal cancer screening. Can you talk a little bit about the PrEP and how perhaps it is reducing how much a person has to drink or how much a person has to prepare, that it's, you know, not what it used to be. I know when I had mine, it was just way too easy. And I kept saying, this isn't going to work. This can't possibly work, because the last time I did this, I had a whole bunch of stuff to do. Can you talk a little bit more about the differences?
Yes. So they do have different PrEP options, and it's important to ask for them, because the first PrEP option that I was given was the ginormous container Oh Go Lightly. And I called back and I said, I want one of the newer PrEP options. So I got the Sure PrEP, which was 2 little bottles. So super easy to drink, but they just want you to drink lots of water, because you do end up using the bathroom a lot. So they don't want you to get dehydrated. That's the most important thing they are trying to prevent. But you can drink water with Crystal Light in it that has a lemon flavor, or you can put lemon in it. You can, whatever's easiest for you to get you to drink it, that's what's most important. So the PrEP isn't that hard. And one of the best things I would recommend is I went to a Japanese restaurant and I get a big container of soup broth, which their soup broth is really good and without anything in it. And that saved me, because it's kind of salty and it's made me feel like I was eating something when I was just drinking it. But that really made me feel like I had some food. So it really was, I was dreading it. And it really wasn't as bad as I thought.
Oh, that's really good information for any of us that have to have a colonoscopy. So we really do appreciate you sharing that tip with us. Anything helps when you have to do the colonoscopy prep, but it is the gold standard, as which you've shared with us. It is the one that is preferred, although there are other options. It is the gold standard for screening. And we really appreciate you sharing all of this with us cancer screening is so important, especially in the African-American, the Black community, yes. because of those disparities, is because of the incidence rates. And so even though I noticed that we're not necessarily diagnosed more frequently, but the incident of death is much higher. And so I think that we all can be our brother and our sister's keeper by encouraging the people around us to get screened for these three issues, be it colon cancer, breast cancer, or lung cancer. We are our brother's keeper, and it's so important to encourage folks to get screened. And Carolyn, your expertise just really adds icing on the cake, and we really do appreciate you sharing your knowledge and your understanding of breast cancers and lung cancer and colorectal cancer with us, because we want our loved ones to continue to live, and we really appreciate you sharing this. And so thank you very much. I am going to turn this over right now to, we're gonna give you a virtual applause right now for your wonderful presentation. And right now I'm gonna turn this over to Avalee DeLay, and she is gonna tell our audience what's up next. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn and Carolyn, so much for that presentation. Next week is our final presentation during Minority Health Month. We're skipping over a little bit into May. So next week from 6 to 7 will be the Mission Possible, Moving the Needle Forward to Advanced Health Equity. We hope to see you all there. And thank you so much for attending tonight.